Welcome to another episode of Encountering Jesus. My name is Cindy Johnston, and I'm your host. This particular series, The Heart of Stone, is about our attitudes in our heart that create walls and hardened places that Jesus wants us to surrender. And I remember this happened initially when I first began encountering Jesus. I would have times with Jesus, and if you've read my book, you know I've talked about the queen stuff. And people find that very offensive. I just want you to know, they do. And one day I was spending time with a very sweet friend who I was, you know, in a lot of ways I would have never thought her to be religious. But I tell her that Jesus told me I'm a queen. And I might have said that I'm queen. You know, I don't know how I worded it, but whatever I did. Oh, she looked at me with fire and she said, well, I'm a queen too. And I just was stunned. I just sat there, you know, kind of like, wow, what just happened? And I said, well, of course. And I never quite got what I had done until I really began to look at, why people are so offended by that. And one, it's outside of their box. They're like, what does that mean? You know, you sound, you know, to assume that you have this place. That, you know, with Jesus is absolutely insane. You know, because it's not in scripture, other than the parts that we see that say, you know, we will sit on the throne with him there at the end of Revelations 3, I think it's 3:21, that when we're victorious, we'll sit on the throne with him and as he sat on the throne with his father. And we also see it in, I want to say Ephesians talks about us being heirs with Jesus. We're co-heirs. And if Jesus is a king and we're a co-heir, then we're kings and queens. But it's pretty offensive to tell someone that you're the queen or a queen. And so I found that, you know, I stopped talking about it very much because I did not want to incite people being offended. But part of the reason they're offended, and it's the same thing that happened with Jesus, when he began to tell people that he was the Son of God, oh my gosh. I actually think that's why they had to have him killed. Because once the Jewish leaders heard him say that, that like took everything to a whole new level. And Jesus was even saying things to let them know he was God, because he would say things like, I am. Well, God was the only one that ever said, I am. And so they were like, oh my gosh, we are going to kill you. And it could be that they started plotting and planning it pretty much at that point. And so I want you to understand that the spirit of religion will always find our places, our heavenly places, our genuine connections with God offensive. They will find them so outrageously offensive. And I'm going to tell you, you've got a place like that. You have a place like that. I'm sure that when Mary first told Joseph what her place was, that she was going to be the mother of the Messiah, he's like, yeah, uh-huh. And he didn't want anything to do with her. He was going to divorce her quietly. And I'm not sure, maybe he was doing that out of his love for her. Or maybe he was scared of her. I don't know. But, you know, he wasn't going to have any part of this. And, you know, I would say most of the time when we're genuinely walking out what God is doing, people should get offended, because there should be enough connection with who we really are in the heavens that when we talk about it here on earth, that that spirit of religion is offended. Now, I just thought of something, and I want you to get this, because it's hard to understand the spirit of religion. One time, I was in a conference. I want to say it was Chuck Pierce. And they had, Potter, two people that do music, and I want to say their last name was Potter. But at any rate, he was playing and singing, and his wife got up and danced in a way that was crazy. And I sat there just going, what the heck? You know, it was not nice. It was kind of offensive. And I thought, what is going on? And then light bulb, I realized she was battling the spirit of religion in that church. So then I got in on it. And I like to do the flags, and I started doing the flags and just really went at it with her. And it was the first time I understood that to break a spirit of religion, you have to be radical and you have to be offensive. And I think that's partly why Jesus was so confrontational in the things that he was saying, because no one would have been able to hear him had he not really confronted that spirit. And so we are going to have to do that in ourselves. And we're going to have to get real with this, because it's not easy. I can tell you now, that part of you is going to fight. And it's going to disagree. And it's not going to like what's being said or done. And you're going to find reasons to excuse in practical ways why you're holding on to these things. And so I want you now just to get that firmly in your heart and mind, that you might be in a little bit of a battle over this. And it's just going to take a little tenacity on your part to keep bringing your heart. And you know, at the end of this course, I did think that we were going to move quicker. And I probably have said that in the earlier courses, but in case I haven't, that we're going to take it a little slower. Because I want to, you know, be sure that we have covered all the areas that are going to be needed for you to have that really wonderful experience with Jesus. And I am going to give you little ways along the way, I think, but we'll see. I always think I want to do that, but then as I start to try to do it, I realize you're still not ready. And so, you know, I understand that things take time. 12 weeks isn't that long. So we're just going to stay the course. So, more about how to deal with our spirit of religion. Whatever you're holding on to in the Word of God, in your doctrines, in your theologies, that you raise above your relationship with Jesus Christ, is religious. There should never be anything that we hold on to more than Jesus Christ himself. He is the living Word of God. And so everything we believe, all the scriptures, all the things that we've been taught in our church, all have to be surrendered to the person of Jesus Christ. Now, there is a really good book that really addresses some of this, and it's called The Beautiful Outlaw by John Eldridge. And this book will help you begin to understand how the church has misrepresented at times the person of Jesus Christ. Not intentional. We just have to keep growing, and you know, I may have said this before, but the Lord just has to keep steering his church. Just think about this. So you've got the Jewish leaders of Jesus' day kill him, kill God's son. So there needed to be a true reformation there. We know that that was the plan, but the church was in terrible shape. They had totally lost sight of God's heart, totally. And this is what happens over time. It's just part of the battle. And so then we see the Catholic Church raises up after Jesus dies. The Catholic Church takes hold and begins to do its part in getting things steered away. You know, it takes the Word of God and does not let ordinary people have it. Then it, you know, we go through a time where they're killing people. They're literally torturing and killing people to get them to confess Jesus Christ. I mean, we laugh at that now because we're like, that's crazy. That is so ineffective. But it just goes to show you how off base we get. They thought those confessions were real. And I'm sure lots of people went on to hell. I'm sorry, I should not be laughing at that. Because these people thought they were doing the right thing by killing them to get them to confess Jesus Christ. I take that back. Jesus, he's fair. He's a fair judge, and he will judge those situations rightly. But I'm just saying, the whole thing is beyond ridiculous. And we can see that now. Just like we can see why Jesus told the people in chapter 6 of John that they had to eat his flesh and drink his blood. Every one of them left Jesus. The day before, they were all getting ready. Well, I'll tell you what. Let me continue that story tomorrow. We are out of time again, so let's focus on what we just covered. So the spirit of religion in us, in around us, the things that we're holding on to, is going to be offended as we deal with it. So let's bring it all before Jesus. Jesus, we know that what we've got going on is always a battle between our flesh man and our spirit man. It's between the flesh man and the spirit man. And this battle can only be won by you. That's what Paul writes. Praise be to God for Jesus Christ. You are the only answer to our blindness, to our hardened hearts. You're the only answer. You are literally the one that comes and reforms and transforms and softens all those hardened places as we humble ourselves and as we admit we've raised up standards that are above you. Like the Jewish leaders, when you said you were the Son of God, their standard was, that is not okay. You deserve to die. And yet you were the Son of God. We are all called to be kings and queens. There should be no shame in saying that. And yet, said in the wrong way, people are so offended. Jesus, we need you. We need you to help us get straight what's important to you. Only you can do that. Only you can soften these hardened places. And I just ask that you would now. I ask that you would soften the places in our hearts that are raised up against you. Doctrines and theologies and standards that we have, inner codes that we live by, that we think please you. And yet, if you came and confronted those places, we would choose them over you. Help us, Jesus, to get this. Help us to see truly who you are. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, I will talk to you guys later. Bye now. Thank you for listening to my podcast. I have more podcast series, and you can find them on my website, heavensdoor41.com. Okay, have a blessed day. Bye.